Detection of various bone tumors and its extent by MRI. Myself, Dr. Shreya Bontarka, a third year resident of Surat Municipal Institute of Medical Education and Research Center. Special thanks to my co-authors, Dr. Mona Shastri, Dr. Ekta Desai, Dr. Nehal Devanji, and Dr. Nirav Kadwani. Introduction. Bone lesions are very diverse in nature, gross and histological features, and this diversity makes it very critical to diagnose the tumors correctly, stage them, so that patient not only survives, but also maintains optimal function of the affected body parts. In the present study, imaging of bone tumors and role of MRI is seen in diagnosis, management, treatment, and follow-up. We all know that X-ray is preliminary and shows the lesion characterization, whether it is lytic, sclerotic, location, matrix, zone of transition, type of destruction, and soft tissue component. But why MRI is essential? MRI is essential for lesion characterization, marrow edema, extent of tumor into soft tissues and medullary canal, neurovascular bundle involvement, staging of tumor, complications, treatment planning, and follow-up. Aims and objectives. Determination of a suspected bone tumor or tumor-like conditions on X-ray, characterization of lesion and its extent on MRI, and to study relative incidence of various tumors and tumor-like conditions. Materials and methods. An observational study was conducted. About 32 consecutive patients were studied who had bony complaints. MRI was performed using 1.5 Tesla Phillips machine and various sequences like T1, T2, PD, and STIR were taken. Few of the patients also underwent CT. Then correlating X-ray findings with other radiological modalities to know the role of MRI in planning management of 32 patients for study. Approach to diagnosis. Now, whenever there is a lesion on plain radiograph, there is an approach based upon whether the lesion is lytic or sclerotic, then based upon the age of the patient, location of the lesion, and other miscellaneous characteristics like periosteal reaction, cortical destruction. Observation and results. Maximum age group which was affected was 11 to 20 years. Males were more affected than females. In bone involvement, most of the bone involvement was monoostotic, and axillary and appendicular skeleton were equally involved. Location within the tumor. Now, most of the tumor locations were in metaphyseal region followed by diaphysis, and most of the tumors were malignant. Even there were tumor mimics, 7 cases were of tumor mimics. Now this patient came with pain and restriction of movement. The X-ray showed a lytic lesion with multiple septations. Axial T1-weighted image showed a heterogeneous hypointense lesion with septations. Sagittal and axial T2 and PD-weighted images showed the hyperintense lesion. It had multiple fluid levels, which depicts the degrees of hemorrhage in aneurysmal bone cysts. It is not pathognomy of aneurysmal bone cyst, but it is very commonly seen. Simple bone cyst. Now, coronal T1 weighted image showed a well-defined hypointense lesion in right atlas bone. It was hypointense on T1 and hyperintense on T2. It was an incidental finding, a simple bone cyst, and the patient had no complaint. This patient presented to us with night pain, which was gradually increasing, and it was relieved by NSAID. Sagittal T1 weighted image showed a focal hypointense nidus with Addison's sclerosis. Axial T2 and coronal PD images showed heterogeneous intramedullary nidus in upper diaphysis with surrounding sclerosis and edema. So MRI is very useful to see the edema pattern, whether it is intramedullary or not. And edema is well seen on MRI. Osteosarcoma. This is a bone destruction along with new bone formation in a sundry pattern at the upper end of tumor, and there was lifting of periosteum causing Codman's triangle. Coronal PD images and axial T2 both images showed the tumor had both intra and extraosseous extent, and it had not reached the epiphyseal plate. In the second image of axial T2 weighted, it showed heterogeneous tumor mass which had reached the cortex and extended into soft tissue component. And chondroma. It was an incidental finding. Coronal T1 images showed an intramedullary diaphyseal serpiginous hypointense lesion. Coronal and axial T2 and PD weighted images showed it appeared hyperintense. Ring and arc type of calcification, which appears as internal low signal on T1 and T2, was seen. It represents chondroid matrix. Osteochondroma. The patient presented with localized swelling without restriction of movement. T1 weighted image showed a well-defined bony outgrowth which was arising from proximal fibula, which was directed away from the joint. Now, PDA and sagittal images showed the T2 hyperintense cartilage gap, which was less than 15 mm. It is very important. MRI is very important to look for cartilage gap for malignant transformation. If the cartilage gap exceeds more than 15 mm in adults and more than 30 mm in kids, it goes towards malignant transformation, most commonly chondrosarcoma. And this patient also had concomitant features of bursitis. Giant cell tumor. X-ray showed an expansal eccentric lytic lesion in proximal lateral tibial condyle. The margins of the lesions were largely non-sclerotic. T2-weighted image showed cytogenously high signal with internal low signal, which represented fibrosis or hemosiderin. CT was also done and large radiolucent lesion was seen with marked thinning of the cortex. This patient presented with localized swelling and pain. T1-weighted images showed there was a well-defined hypointense lesion. PD coronal and sagittal images showed the lesion was hyperintense and was causing expansion and destruction of adjacent cortex. Histopathology proved it to be a giant cell tumor. Metastasis. Radiograph, you can see there is a destruction of left pedicle of T11 and inferior end plate. These are axial T1-weighted images, sagittal T1 and sagittal T2-weighted images. Now, this patient presented to us with lower leg pain and swelling. The patient had no complaints of fever. There was restriction of movement. X-ray of the patient showed a well-defined osteolytic lesion in epimetaphyseal region. It was thought to be a bone tumor. When MRI was done, it showed hypointense lesion on T1, hyperintense on T2, and it showed diffusion restriction. It turned out to be an infective etiology on biopsy. It was Brody's abscess. So, it was a tumor mimic. So, summary and conclusion. Out of 32 patients, higher male preponderance was there. Highest incidence was in second and sixth decade. Axial and appendicular skeleton were commonly equally involved. Metaphyseal region was more commonly involved. Tumor were more towards malignant side. And MRI was more sensitive for lesion detection because it was essential for lesion characterization, marrow edema, neurovascular bundle involvement, staging, treatment planning, and follow-up. Thank you.